William Knight, the publisher of New Consciousness Review, a digital multimedia magazine and website where we review the top books and films having an impact on the global awakening. Our website is ncreview.com. On this show, we explore the many and varied faces of conscious awakening and what that can mean in your life. So today's guest is Julia Schopick. She is a patient advocate, health writer, and creator of the award-winning blog, Honest Medicine. Her columns and articles have appeared widely in the national press. Her mission is to inform people about little-known but promising treatments and to empower them in making healthcare choices. She is the author of the Amazon best-selling book, Honest Medicine, Effective, Time-Tested, Inexpensive Treatments for Life-Threatening Diseases. Welcome, Julia.
Thank you so much, Miriam. That book title is a mouthful, isn't it?
Isn't it, though? Yes, taglines are wonderful, but you forget that people actually need to read them.
Right.
Anyway, today, dear listener, we are going to talk about learning to listen to your gut when your doctor's advice isn't helping, and also why it's so important to be an empowered patient, and why doctors sometimes don't like empowered patients. So anyway, Julia, how are you going to kick us off on this discussion?
Well, there are any number of avenues we can take. Why don't I start by talking about the fact that how I learned to listen to my gut. How would that sound?
That sounds great.
Okay, because I want to tell you that originally I was not somebody who listened to her gut as far as healthcare decisions. As a matter of fact, I was terrified of having any interaction with the medical profession. Because my dad was a doctor who basically, he told me he did not like what was going on in medicine, and therefore I should keep away from doctors as much as I could, you know. So I did.
Advice.
And I know it's funny, isn't it, to think of it, but he really, really meant that. I mean, his most famous quote, made famous by me, of course, is, if a doctor tells you he knows all the answers, run like hell. So you can tell he really did teach me, you know, to stay away. But in 1990, my husband, he was only 40 years old. It was only 5 years after we'd gotten married, actually. He was diagnosed with a brain tumor, and it was the size of an orange. And that's huge. Doctors like to compare tumors to the size of fruit, as you probably know. I have to tell you, I did not decide to start researching the way I'm going to be telling your listeners to do. I was not that kind of empowered patient that we're going to be talking about. I was terrified. And my husband was terrified. And we actually stood in lockstep and did exactly what the doctors advised, nothing more, nothing less. And so he had the surgery, and that was a call for, because the tumor was huge. Then he had radiation, then he had chemotherapy. I'm not sure still, Miriam, whether the chemotherapy was the right decision. But in any case, the point I'm making is that we really didn't step out of the box the way I'm going to be telling your listeners that they really should. We didn't. And I began to notice that he was only given 3 years to live. The doctor said it's a serious brain tumor. He probably has 18 months to 3 years. And, of course, that frightened us even more, right?
Yeah.
But in any case, he did outlive his prognosis. And I began to notice that he was developing every single side effect, every complication that I was reading about online. He got what's called hydrocephalus, water on the brain, which required numerous surgeries, going in to put a shunt in, then the shunt malfunctioned. I won't go into details. They're in the book, but, you know, not in terribly detailed fashion, but they're all there in my book, Honest Medicine. He even had a radiation-caused stroke. And finally, I said, got to start doing something. And I started researching. My gut started waking up. And I started doing some research, and I found a nutritionist who really knew a lot about cancer and brain tumors especially. And he started to flourish. And what I noticed was that the doctors, he was doing much, much better. And the doctors could not have been less interested in what we were doing. And that didn't bother me, frankly, because in a selfish way, I was just pleased that my husband was outliving his prognosis and feeling good. But then in 2000, 2001, he had a recurrence of the tumor. And at that point, his skin would not heal. He had had too many times when they had gone in for, quote, minor procedures like the hydrocephalus, and his skin just wouldn't heal. And they kept bringing him back into the operating room and doing more and more surgeries till he ended up having 8 surgeries, additional surgeries. And one of the last one was also taking grafts from all over his body. And I was frantic, and I was researching. I was following my gut, but nothing was working, you know, because the doctors wouldn't read any of the research I had found. And then a holistic doctor, an integrative doctor friend, found a product that is the first product I write about in my book, in Honest Medicine. It's called Silverlon, S-I-L-V-E-R-L-O-N, and it's pieces of material with silver ions. And as the doctor who told me about it said, it's FDA approved for all non-healing wounds. Long story short, I got permission. The story is quite dramatic as to how I got permission, but I'll leave that to your listeners to read about it. But in any case, we put it on his head. His skin started healing, and I was sure his doctors would be excited as I was. I mean, here, you know, my husband, because of all the treatments, all the extra surgeries, was now in pretty bad shape, but he was alive. And I was wondering why the doctors weren't coming over and telling me how great it was that he was alive. And one doctor came up to me and he said, you know, we don't think it was what you found with the accent on you that worked to heal your husband's skin. And I said, well, what do you think it is? And he said, we think it was vancomycin. And that's the IV antibiotic that my husband had been on for at least 6 weeks. And I said, but he's been on vancomycin. He's had the IV for at least 6 weeks. And the doctor said the words that turned me into a patient advocate. They were, vancomycin is like that. It kicks in. And I vowed that something was really wrong with the medical system and that following one's own gut was something that I had to be there and help other people to do. Because doctors were not used to being partners with patients, and I knew that that was necessary. I had found through a doctor, I'm not a doctor, but I had found something that worked, and the doctors were not interested in partnering with me, and that's what my mission is all about.
That's a pretty tall order for yourself. Actually, you're talking about changing the medical mindset.
It's hard. Miriam, you bring up a wonderful point. I'm not sure it's possible to change the medical mindset. All I can do is to use, I didn't tell you this, but I was a college teacher before I did public relations. And so I'm trying to use my combination of PR and teaching skills, education, to help patients to perhaps influence their doctors. So that's what I'm about.
Well, let's go back to when you and your husband first faced this diagnosis. It's a very overwhelming thing when a doctor tells you that you have a life-threatening illness and you have an expiration date. And you're grasping at straws, and because doctors are trained to at least project a sense of confidence, you're going to grasp at that sense of confidence that you get from him, and you'll do anything he says. So how do you think that people in that situation can actually get the courage to say, okay, let's look at this a little more closely?
It's hard. I think, and I grapple with it, and my friends grapple with it. All of us, by the way, are very assertive kinds of people. But I think that you just have to look at it and say, you know, the doctor does not know everything. And what I ask people to do is to also remember the way doctors are not educated, they're trained. One of the chapters in Honest Medicine in my book is contributed by Dr. Bert Berkson, where he talks about how doctors really are trained and they're not educated. And education means, you know, training is when you're told to follow orders, you know, just do exactly what your teachers told you, do exactly what's in the medical books, you know, all of that. Mm-hmm. Education is questioning. And just realize, you know, in my book, Dr. Gluck says, be compassionate toward doctors. I don't know if I have mastered that, if you want to know the truth, Miriam. He points out that they do have a deficit, you know, that both Dr. Gluck and Dr. Berkson, that doctors are really, they're not perfect at all, and they have a deficit. They're not educated correctly, and they also get a lot of their education or training from pharmaceutical reps. So keep all this in mind, and it will give you more courage, is all I'm trying to say.
And I think there's another aspect, Julia, which is that there is a standard that the AMA sets out for being the standard of care. And anyone, and there are a lot of more forward-thinking doctors who have strayed from that standard of care. And it doesn't matter if your patients get better as a result. You can still be pilloried by the medical establishment if you step outside that box.
Yeah, that's a very, very, very important point. There is one state, I don't think I'll say which one it is, but because I don't want people coming after me about it, but there's one state that's particularly hard this way. And as a matter of fact, there is a doctor in that state, Dr. Stanislav Brzezinski, and he has developed a cancer treatment called anti-neoplastons that has been very successful, you know, for a lot of cancer patients. And he has literally been pilloried, not only by his fellow doctors, we think they probably did, quote, turn him in, but the medical board keeps bringing him up before the board. It's terrifying. So
it's interesting. I happen to know that case very well, and the lengths that he has had to go to protect himself in terms of getting all of the regulations, you know, staying inside the line of the regulations, getting the permission to do clinical trials and so forth, and many, many different ways of protecting himself. And even so, when he went to get clinical trials, he found that the head of the FDA had subverted one of his colleagues, and they had put a patent in on his technique after they couldn't convince him to sell it to them.
The consensus seems to be that everybody, that the powers that be seem to be upset with him. And I hope I'm not speaking out of turn, because he will not play ball, and you know he will not sell his invention, his patents, to a pharmaceutical company.
Now, a lot of doctors who come up with these inventions know that if they were to be sold to a pharmaceutical company, they would be essentially shelved, so that they wouldn't compete with existing drugs. Because a lot of these interventions, particularly the ones that you have in your book, are low-cost interventions. They're more effective, they're much cheaper, and they would directly impinge on the profits of the pharmaceutical companies.
They will license, I guess is the word, the invention. They'll purchase the patents or license it, and then, as you said, they'll shelve them. because they're not. What they're really saying is, hey, you know, you have I have a drug for multiple sclerosis. I'm pretending I'm the pharmaceutical company person talking now. We have drugs for MS, multiple sclerosis. We have drugs for Crohn's. We have drugs for fibromyalgia. We have drugs for chronic fatigue. And here is this little whippersnapper, small, you know, inexpensive treatment called low-dose naltrexone, one of the treatments that I profile in my book, In Honest Medicine. And this is supposed to be a good treatment for all of those and more? Oh, no, we don't want that. We want a one disease or even one symptom, one drug model. So you're absolutely right. The company would buy it and shelve it. So this is scary.
Now, on low-dose naltrexone, tell us the difference in price between a month on that versus a month on the pharmaceutical.
Oh, my God. Okay, recently, I love this question. It's so bizarre because the answer to it is bizarre, not your question. But there was recently an article, you know, I'm pretty big on Facebook, so whenever I see an article that speaks to me, you know, and I know it will speak to my followers, I post it. There was recently, I believe it was an article in New England Journal. I'm not positive. I can look it up, though.
New England Journal of Medicine.
Yeah, I believe so, which said that the cheapest MS multiple sclerosis drug was $50,000 a year. And, you know, so the MS patients who were also followers of low-dose naltrexone, they shared it all over. You know, I posted it. And because guess how much low-dose naltrexone costs? I mean, it's really pennies. You know, one of the compounding pharmacies that I know, Skip Lenz, and he's one of the biggest proponents of low-dose naltrexone, I think he charges like $20 a month or something like that. So I have the compilations in my book in where I say, you know, that these drugs, I specifically talked about the MS drugs, the multiple sclerosis drugs, and I believe it was thousands of times more expensive than low-dose naltrexone. So this is a problem for the pharmaceutical companies don't like it. And this is also true of the other treatments in my book, you know, that are much less expensive than the standard. I mean, intravenous alpha lipoic acid has kept a lot of people from needing liver transplants. I didn't do my due diligence and find out how much a liver transplant costs, but you just can imagine that the hospitals would hate to have some of their business go, you know, and the doctors. And the ketogenic diet, another one of the treatments that I write about, I mean, that's just food, you know. All the child has to do is be in the hospital for a week or so till they get the diet, which is a high-fat, low-carbohydrate, low-protein diet, till they get it regulated correctly, and then it's just food from then on.
And that was for childhood epilepsy, was it?
Yeah. Excuse me for not saying that. For childhood epilepsy. And so these are very, very inexpensive treatments. And one of the reasons I'm out there, Miriam, is that, you know, there is a book called The Bitter Pill by Stephen Brill, where he basically says that we are going to go broke, something that, of course, is no big surprise, you know, because with the health care bill, there were no price dampening things built in. You know, the pharmaceutical companies can charge whatever they want, and so can big industry. And, you know, the MRIs, the CT scans, and we're going to go broke. And here, my book and other books like it have answers that could save healthcare. And I'm not an economist, and I'm not, you know, a policy wonk, but doesn't it make sense that they should try to listen to some of these, to use some of these treatments and others like them?
Well, you know, in the Hippocratic Oath, it says, first, do no harm.
Oh, well, that's a long time ago, huh?
They have strayed from the roots, yes. It's interesting that in China, doctors are paid a retainer to keep families healthy, and if anyone gets sick, they stop getting paid.
Wouldn't that be wonderful? I've heard about that, and you know what? After we get after we stop our interview, I'm going to look for an article to post on Facebook which speaks to that very thing, because you're absolutely right. Say, isn't that a wonderful model that we should be using?
Absolutely.
And I've known about it. But, you know, the first do no harm. You know, doctors must, and I hate to be just, you know, going off on a tangent here, but they must lose something when they, you know, they give. I take MS, multiple sclerosis, as an example, because the drugs are so dangerous. Well, let's take autoimmune diseases.
Julia, what website can people go to find out or to connect?
You know what? It's going to be a big surprise. It's honestmedicine.com. And my email is julia@honestmedicine.com. And the book is Honest Medicine. I should trademark that, shouldn't I?
I just hope people don't think it's an oxymoron.
I don't know if you watched the video, which is on my website, of me talking to the Cancer Control Society, but I tell the story in that video of how I was on Dr. Ron Hoffman's show, the first show I ever did, you know, after the book was published,
mm-hmm.
and he started right out by asking that question. He said, "Honest medicine. Does that mean that you think that a lot of medicine is dishonest?" You know, so he was right there asking about the oxymoronic trait to my title.
Now, I don't want people to think that we are just getting down on doctors.
No.
We're really looking at this holistically, at the system of education of doctors, at the system of regulation of doctors, at the system of paying doctors for their skills. And too often, the route to making a living is pushing drugs rather than really practicing medicine. When I lived in the UK, I actually ran a temp agency for medical personnel, and it was very difficult to get GPs because a lot of them were either committing suicide, becoming drug addicts, or leaving practice. It's a terribly difficult job, and I have nothing but admiration for people who are truly motivated to serve humanity by going into medicine. And what we are calling for here is a change in mindset, a change in attitude, of opening of the mind to other kinder, gentler, cheaper ways of making people well. So, Julia,
May I first say that I'm very glad you said that, because sometimes when I start talking about it, I just get so frustrated that I hope I'm not sounding like I'm trying to bash all doctors, because you're absolutely right. As a matter of fact, several of the heroes of my book are doctors who were curious and stepped outside the box. But I am trying to work on changing a bit of a mindset here. You're right.
Okay, now, if we're talking about empowering patients, how is someone to be able to distinguish a promising treatment from one that's not promising? Because unfortunately, on the other side of the divide between doctors and the pharmaceutical companies are alternative medicines, but there's also a lot of quackery out there, and unfortunately, people do like to prey on people who are in distress and who are desperate. You know, so you know they might grasp at any straw. How do you tell the good stuff from the bad?
Thanks for asking that question. And the answer, one day when I figure it out exactly to the T, I can give some direction, though. But I will conduct teleseminars or webinars to teach people literally how to find, you know, the good treatments. But the answer, I can give a broad answer to your question, and that is be very, very careful when you go online. First of all, there's the subtitle of a lot of the contributors of my book of Honest Medicine was "Thank God for the Internet," because they found wonderful treatments on the Internet. But the truth is what you said as well, that out there there's a lot of, I hate to use the words, but snake oil. And I can tell you a few ways to tell. One is, if they're flashing lights proclaiming that this is a cure, you know, for all all diseases or for all cancers or something like that, you know, and you can just tell. Just use your common sense if there are words like that. The other thing, and I'm afraid that a lot of people are not going to have the skills to do this because we're becoming so, how can I say it, people are not reading as much anymore. But you can often tell because these websites that I was talking about, you know, with the flashing lights and saying it's a miracle cure, often it's just badly written, bad grammar, bad spelling. And those are certain ways that you can tell. Look to see, though. I've coined a new expression in my book. I don't think a treatment has to be, you know, with all the huge clinical trials behind it. Because, as you pointed out, Miriam, these treatments that I write about and that others write about that are good treatments wouldn't pay any pharmaceutical company to do the huge clinical trials on them. And pharmaceutical companies are the ones that do them. So don't always say that if a treatment doesn't have, you know, the phase 3 double-blind clinical trials, that it's no good. But look for what I coined, patient evidence-based medicine. Often this is called anecdotal. I don't think it is. But read whether people have had good results. One good sign is, for instance, with something like low-dose naltrexone, there are actually several Facebook groups dedicated to helping people to find low-dose naltrexone, to get their doctors to prescribe it.
Or to find a doctor who will prescribe it.
Excuse me?
Or to find a doctor who will prescribe it.
Yeah, well, the doctors who will prescribe it, absolutely, there are people who will help them. I'm one of them who can help them find a doctor. But the doctors' names are usually not posted on the internet, but there are people out there who help people to find a doctor who will, yes.
And we should just mention on low-dose naltrexone that this is an FDA-approved medicine, but
yes,
it was approved for some other application.
It
so
was.
This is just an application in the case of MS or whatever.
And not only that, but this is a wonderful thing point to mention that, you know, I don't know if your listeners know that any doctor can prescribe a drug, any drug, off-label. That means for a use other than what it was FDA approved for. And in this case, but they're not, the pharmaceutical company cannot market it for diseases other than those for which it was FDA approved. But in this case, we're talking about naltrexone was approved by the FDA in 1984 for drug abuse, and in 1994 for alcoholism. And it was approved at 50 milligrams, 5-0, and doctors were using it at anywhere up to, I believe, 200 and 300 milligrams. And you would give it to a patient who was a drug addict or an alcoholic, and it was supposed to block their craving for the substance and for alcohol or drugs. And so when Dr. Bahari, and we can tell this the origin of this, or if you'd rather just have people read about it in my book, he discovered that at very low doses, at 3 and 4.5 milligrams, it was good for diseases that had at their base an immune system dysfunction, including autoimmune diseases, some cancers. So it's really, it's so non-toxic because it's so much lower than what it was FDA approved for.
Well, I want to talk about the immune system after the break, but we're going to go to break, and we'll be right back with Julia Schopick talking about honest medicine.
Has the universe been trying to get your attention? What will it take for you to start to listen? I'm Miriam Knight, and I interviewed 37 individuals from all walks of life for our book, What Wags the World? Tales of Conscious Awakening. In it, they describe the cosmic 2x4s that changed their lives, and their answers may make you rethink your own ideas about the nature of reality. available on Amazon and Barnes & Noble, or ask for it at your local bookstore. What Wags the World? Tales of Conscious Awakening.
And we are back with Julia Schopick, the Honest Medicine Lady, and her website is honestmedicine.com. Julia, I did want to talk about the immune system, but before that, I think it's important to talk about the relationship with your doctor. I can imagine doctors do not like to be second-guessed. So what is a good way for an empowered patient to approach their doctor?
Well, the first thing I like to tell people, Miriam, is that they should understand where their doctor is coming from. I know I'm stepping back a bit, but I'll try to make this as brief as possible. But they were literally trained. Remember we mentioned trained and not educated? Mm-hmm. They were literally trained to believe that patients were going to just take their advice. You know, the doctor gives his pronouncement, let's use that word rather than advice, as to what the patient should do for a particular illness, you know, and the patient just says, yes, doctor. And so that has changed a bit, and some doctors are saying, well, I'm really open-minded now. So what they decide is patient empowerment is that the doctor gives two or three options about what the treatment should be, and together patient and doctor choose one of the doctor's two or three options. Get the difference between what I'm talking about? Because what I'm talking about is that if, and only, I would say really only if what your doctor is doing is just not working, you're getting worse and worse and worse, and you're feeling worse and worse, I'm talking about becoming what I call an empowered patient. I did not develop that phrase, but did not coin that, but an empowered patient who will bring information to your doctor and say, doctor, together, can we decide whether this treatment would be efficacious for me? And that's what I think you're talking about, right?
Yeah.
So what is necessary is first understanding where the doctor is coming from. He has been educated or trained not to be open. So when you go to your doctor with an idea for a new treatment, don't do. I'm going to give you one big don't. One don't is, don't just say, doctor, I heard of something on the internet. Those are fighting words to your doctor.
A red flag.
You know, my dad, who was a doctor, as I told you in the beginning, he used to come home and say, somebody else just brought me an article from the Reader's Digest and told, you know, about a treatment. Why do they think the Reader's Digest knows more than I do? So today's I found this on the internet is just very similar to I found this in the Reader's Digest. Don't do that. What you should do, yes, go on the internet. I'm not saying you shouldn't do that, but don't say that to your doctor as your first line of attack. What you should really do is get all the information you can about a treatment. Don't just go there and say, I heard of this treatment and what do you think, let's do it. That's just not going to work. But what I advise my clients, I now do some coaching of how to, you know, helping patients to convince their doctors, do all your research and find as many articles as you can, and then go through them and pick the ones about this treatment that are the most convincing. And in the case of low-dose naltrexone, I give the patients a wonderful interview with Dr. Bernard Bahari, who is the man who pioneered, he actually developed the lower doses of naltrexone, the way I told about, you know, for autoimmune diseases. And there's a wonderful interview with him that was published in Alternative Therapies magazine that looks very professional. Don't forget, your doctor will want you to give materials that look professional. So I give them that, and I coach them, point out to your doctor that Dr. Bahari is Harvard educated, that he is board certified in two areas, neurology and psychiatry, and point out that he went to some Harvard associated schools, you know, and got his board certification with them. Point these things out. And then, and this is very, very important, doctors will say, well, there aren't any big trials done. Maybe true, but there are often, and with the case of every treatment in my book, the four treatments, there are definitely small studies that have been done. And by prestigious institutions and published in very prestigious publications. Get them for your doctor. For instance, if you have Crohn's disease and you want to try low-dose naltrexone, there are three studies that were done at Penn State, all of which show that low-dose naltrexone is very useful for Crohn's disease. And they were published. Oh, I said they were done at Penn State, which is a reputable institution. And they were published in, one of them was published in the American Journal of Gastroenterology. So take these studies to your doctor. The best is not to even take abstracts. Bring the entire study as it appeared in the journal. And if there are no studies about the treatment for your particular disease, bring a bunch of, and well put together, abstracts from PubMed. And PubMed is the government-run website that houses all of these studies, big and small, and your doctor loves PubMed. And then put the information into a folder, make it look very professional. Remember I said to get a whole bunch of information? Don't bring a whole bunch to your doctor. Just bring some that you feel are the most convincing. And now that you've educated yourself, make sure that there are publications that you can talk about with your doctor. And here's the biggest mistake patients make is when they bring information, they say, okay, here's the information, what do you think? No good. What you should do is bring the information, say something like the following, you know, I found information about this treatment that seems very, very promising for my particular condition. And doctor, I put together some information, including studies in some very prestigious publications, and I'd like you to take the time and read them, and then I'd like us to set up an appointment to get together and talk about them. This takes the pressure off the doctor for having to give an answer right away. Believe me, he or she will be grateful that you know, that he may not say yes eventually, but you're presenting it in a very professional manner. And usually what I found in my coaching is the doctors will say, yes, let's make an appointment to talk in 2 weeks or 3 weeks. Then you go back, you bring the same packet for yourself, and then you have a conversation. And I try to point out to people exactly how to present the material. But if you have found small studies by going on PubMed, all you need to do is go to Google and put in PubMed, and you know, in the search bar, and you'll get taken right to the website for PubMed. And you put in the term in the PubMed search bar, and you get loads of information comes up. This is the way you have to do your homework. And if you don't, I think you're going to be very disappointed because your doctor is not in the mindset to be happy to hear about a new treatment. So you have to do everything you can to make him or her be more open. So I don't know if I answered it totally, but, you know, those are some hints.
I think that was a great overview.
Thank you.
Before the break, we were talking about the question of low-dose naltrexone and its effect on boosting the immune system. Now, there are a lot of things that can boost the immune system that are not necessarily pharmaceuticals. It's